Today we look at an important fact about international trade, the great prevalence and increasing importance of intra-industry trade. Here's a classic or paradigmatic example of what we typically think about when we think about trade based upon comparative advantage: wheat and cane sugar. So in this example, one country which has the comparative advantage in wheat, it exports wheat and it imports cane sugar. The other country produces and exports cane sugar and it imports wheat. Here's another paradigmatic or classic example, this one from Heckscher-Ohlin theory: jet aircraft and shoes, or a high skill, a high capital intensive good, and a low skill, low capital intensive good. Again, the key here is that one country exports the jets and imports the shoes. The other country exports the low capital, low skill good, the shoes, and it imports the high skill, high capital good, the jets. Now, when we actually look at the trade data, however, what do we see? Well, the paradigmatic example in the data might actually be motorcycles. That is, one country exports these motorcycles and imports these motorcycles, and the other country imports these and exports these. Now, that's a little peculiar, because at first glance, these motorcycles look awfully similar. Why should one country be exporting one and importing the other, and vice versa for the other country? And yet, this intra-industry trade, trade based upon similar goods, where one country is both exporting and importing the same good or a similar good, turns out to be very common. This intra-industry trade is what this lecture is all about. So intra-industry trade is the share of trade that is within or intra the industry, rather than across sectors. It's typically measured by the Grubel-Lloyd Index or other indexes, but this one is the one which is most common. Let's show how this Grubel-Lloyd Index works. Let's first hear the top is the absolute value of exports minus imports divided by the sum of exports and imports. So for example, suppose there's a good which a country exports but does not import. Well, then imports are going to be 0. This number is going to be 1. 1 minus 1 is 0. So in that case, intra-industry trade would be 0. That is, if we have a good which we export but don't import, intra-industry trade, as measured by the Grubel-Lloyd Index, will be 0. Same thing if there's a good for which we import, but we don't export it. On the other hand, suppose that exports equal imports. Okay, so we have a good for which the number of exports is about the same as the number of imports. Then this is 0 and this is 1. So the Grubel-Lloyd Index for a good which we both export and import would be equal to 1. So let's give some examples. So in 2010, the US exported $170 million worth of raw sugarcane, and it imported $1.9 billion of raw sugarcane. So this is a case where we import a lot of the good and export hardly any at all, so we should have a number which is close to 0. And in fact, when you do the calculation, you find that for cane sugar, the Grubel-Lloyd Index is 0.164. In other words, there's not very much intra-industry trade. On the other hand, what about motorcycles? Well, in 2010, the U.S. exported about $1 billion worth of motorcycles, and we also imported about $1.2 billion worth of motorcycles. So if you calculate the Grubel-Lloyd Index, what you find is it should be close to 1, and in fact it is. It's 0.909. So that's how you calculate intra-industry trade. Let's look at what it is across some different countries. To measure the amount of intra-industry trade by country, we're going to take those indexes which we just calculated by product or by industry in the last slide, and we're going to sum them all up, weighting each by the share of total trade. And if you do that, you can get an intra-industry trade statistic for the country as a whole. And a bunch of these are shown over here. These are measured in really just the same way. Instead of 0.9, it's multiplied by 100 to get us 90. But what this indicates is that countries near the top, most of their trade is intra-industry trade. So Belgium, France, United Kingdom, Spain, they are importing and exporting very many similar goods. Even the United States has a intra-industry trade statistic of 72. So that means the paradigmatic example for the United States is not the cane sugar example, which had a intra-industry statistic of about 0.1, but instead is the motorcycle example, closer to the motorcycle. So the United States is often importing and exporting similar goods. Down here towards the bottom, we get countries which have lower levels of intra-industry trade. Australia and Chile, for example, these countries export a lot of minerals, which they don't so much import, so their values are lower. For most developed countries in the world, however, the intra-industry trade statistic is very high indeed. Intra-industry trade also varies by the industry that we're talking about. So for medical and pharmaceutical products, the United States both exports a lot of these products, but it imports a lot of them as well. So intra-industry trade is very high. On the other hand, for footwear, the United States mostly imports footwear. It doesn't export footwear. And for other countries as well, the other countries may export a lot of footwear and not import a lot of footwear. So around the world, in fact, footwear tends to have low intra-industry trade. You're either exporting it or you're importing it, not both. Same thing with medical and pharmaceutical products. You're probably doing both exporting and importing those products. There's some hint here, by the way, that the countries, or excuse me, that the industries with high intra-industry trade show a little bit more monopoly power, a little bit more suitable for perhaps for monopolistic competition. That's the theory that we're working towards, and there's some evidence for that, though just a little bit, in this kind of description here. What this graph shows is that intra-industry trade has become more important as a total share of world trade. So if we go back to that paradigmatic example of comparative advantage of trading wheat for cane sugar, in Ricardo's time, that example was indeed representative. That wheat for cane sugar idea, intra-industry trade was quite low. So that example at that time was representative. But we're moving from a world in which trading wheat for cane sugar is representative towards one in which trading motorcycle for motorcycle is representative. Okay, these are important facts to know, but what does it all mean? I've already hinted at sort of a traditional story, which is not quite correct, but let's give the traditional story. It's that comparative advantage and Heckscher-Ohlin theory explains trade across different goods or countries, and thus has difficulty explaining intra-industry trade. So the fact of intra-industry trade was used to motivate many of the new trade models based upon increasing returns, based upon a product differentiation and monopolistic competition. So Helpman and Krugman, who were key pioneers in this area, said that trade patterns seem to include substantial two-way trade in goods of similar factor intensity. This intra-industry trade seems both pointless and hard to explain from the point of view of conventional trade analysis. So they argued that in order to explain intra-industry trade, you needed a new theory, and the theory which they and others, Krugman in particular was a pioneer, Helpman too, was one based upon product differentiation, internal economies of scale, and monopolistic competition. And that's the theory which we're moving towards, but we have to provide one footnote to that before we get there. Once it became clear that the intra-industry fact was important, theorists began to ask, is it really the case that the only theory capable of explaining inter-industry trade is the increasing returns monopolistic competition theory? And they raised two objections. The first objection, perhaps a more minor objection, but an interesting conceptual one, is what is the right level to define an industry? So we took the industry definition as motorcycles, but that's arbitrary. That was just chosen by a government statistician for entirely different purposes. Why choose that level of definition? If we aggregate even further, we can make almost all trade intra-industry. So for example, if we said that the industry is not motorcycles, but vehicles, then much more of trade is going to be intra-industry. On the other hand, if we said, no, the right level of aggregation is not motorcycles, but big engine motorcycles and small engine motorcycles. Then almost no trade would be inter-industry. If we define the industry to be coincident with the product itself, then no trade would be inter-industry. So it's somewhat arbitrary at what level of aggregation that we choose. Second objection, and a more important one, is that small changes to comparative advantage and Heckscher-Ohlin theory can in fact explain inter-industry trade. And the basic idea is this. In trade theory, an industry means activities with similar factor shares. But if producing, let's say, Harley motorcycles and Kawasaki motorcycles use similar factor shares, and if there's factor price equalization, then precisely because these industries are similar, these products are similar, small differences in productivity can generate lots of specialization. Small differences in productivity in a factor price equalization world can generate lots of specialization. So what do we make of this? Well, my view is that microeconomic evidence suggests that product differentiation, internal increasing returns, and monopolistic competition are important. So even if we look outside the trade theory, there is evidence for these assumptions of the theory. Moreover, this new trade theory does in fact offer a compelling explanation of inter-industry trade and other trade facts. It's also not entirely clear to me whether other theories can explain all of the facts, including, for example, the inter-industry trade statistics by industry. Which industries have the most inter-industry trade? Monopolistic competition theory offers an answer to that based upon monopoly power. It's not clear that Heckscher-Ohlin theory does. But maybe the theorist will come up with something. I don't know. In any case, we're going to be looking closely at new trade theory, even if it cannot be judged to be the only theory capable of explaining the facts. It's certainly an important theory, and we're going to spend some time on it. Here's some further reading. Marius Brulhart has a good account of the statistics across nations. Heltman and Krugman, who were key players in the new trade theory, they summed up a lot of their work from the early 1980s in their book, Market Structure and Foreign Trade. A more recent textbook, Krugman, Obstfeld, and Militz, has some good material on this subject. And the key paper in the counterattack, showing that Heckscher-Ohlin and comparative advantage could explain inter-industry trade, is this important paper by Donald Davis. Thanks.